your mysteries unknown.
I'm never gonna stop.
So I'm never gonna stop, never gonna stop. Lifting up my hands to you, lifting up my heart. When the last day comes and goes, and time will be no more,
well,
I'll be praising you. No, I'll never let it in, I'll just begin it all again. Gonna give a thousand years from now for your throne of grace and power.
Lord,
I'll be praising you, praising you. For your beauty that's been shown. The mirror. on solid ground. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. Makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want.
Maybe singing when the evening comes. Thank you. we have the courage to take the steps we know we need to take. Because you have won our affection, Lord. And if you truly have captured our hearts, then it won't be just from our lips that we speak it, but it'll be from our hearts that we mean it, and it'll be from our feet that we do it. Lord, you have won my affection. Devotion. You see, my worship is yours.
Want my affection. You've captured my heart. Now I am yours. Completely yours.
That's true for you today. I just want you to worship him. No words on the screen. Just worship him right now. No words. Just give him the praise and the worship that he deserves, that he is worthy of. If he's captured your heart, if he's won your affection today, let him know. Let him know how great he is. Let him know how wonderful he is. Right now, just lift him up. Lift him up, church. You don't need words on a screen. You don't need a worship band playing to worship Jesus. Just worship him from your heart right now in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you right now. God, we thank you, Lord, that you are wonderful, that you are great, that you are perfect. You are Creator God, a Creator that loves us enough to have a personal relationship with us. Hallelujah. We give you glory today, Lord God. That you're not just up on a throne, just watching us from afar, but you come and you fellowship with us here today. God, we praise you for that. We praise you, Lord. I worship you, Jesus. Thank you for capturing my heart. Thank you, Lord God, for going after me until I finally said, Lord, I want you. I want you. I want you, Jesus. I want you, Lord. I want you, Jesus. Lord, you capture my heart. Now I want to capture yours. I want to capture yours, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord has recently spoke something to me. It's very elementary, very basic, but it's also very powerful. See, Jesus didn't just love us enough to save us from our sin. He loved us enough to jump in the abyss of sin and rescue us and pull us out of that abyss. And save us from it. You know that's I know that's elementary. I know that's basic. Man, that is so powerful. If you can just picture that, Jesus jumping into the abyss with you of sin and grabbing you and swimming to the shore, pulling you up out of it, and setting you on solid ground where you are now free, where you are now rescued from that sin that you were once in. Church, if we don't have anything else to thank him for today, thank him for rescuing you. He rescued you. He loved you that much that he rescued you. We have an opportunity here this morning to sit at the feet of Jesus for a moment. We have an opportunity just to allow him to speak to us and for our hearts to speak to him. Jeremiah said it this way, if we will seek Him with all our hearts, then we will find Him. Do you want to find Him today? It's our choice. Do we want to find Jesus today? Do we want to come in here and just go through the motions and walk back out the door? It's our choice. I came here to be changed by the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ. And I hope that you're here to allow Him to mold and shape you right now. So as we make this house a house of prayer, you can continue to worship. You can come and bow down at these altars and allow God to minister to you. Or we want to pray for you. We want to lay hands on you and believe God with you for whatever it is that is on your heart today. But I want to take it a step further. You want to praise God. It says in Romans chapter 12 that we are to weep with those who weep and to rejoice with those who rejoice. Prayer should not just be about bringing our burdens and our needs, but it should also be about bringing our praise so we can rejoice with each other. So if you have a praise today, come on up. I'll rejoice with you. But let's make this house a house of prayer. Let's make our focus Jesus Christ right now in this moment. Hallelujah.
Lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold of me, my heart was a stone, I was covered in shame, when He came for me, I couldn't run from His presence, I couldn't run from His arms. Jesus, He loves me. He loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me. He is for me. It was a soul, I'll never be the same. Stepped out of the dark and into the light when He called my name. I couldn't run from His presence. I couldn't run from His arms. Jesus, He loves me, He loves me, He is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, He is for me. He holds the stars and He holds my heart with healing that bear the scars, the rugged cross where He died for me, my only hope, my everything. Jesus, He loves me. He loves me. Can it be? He loves me. He is for me. He loves me. He is for me. My God is amazing, Lord Jesus. was in chains, you gave me love. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame when he came for me. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me. He loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me. He is for me.
Loving us so much. Thank you for redeeming us, God, for saving us and setting us free, God, free to truly live, God, free to thrive, Lord God. And I praise you today for all that you do, God, for who you are, God. You are truly the only one worthy of our praise, worthy of all glory, the only one, God. No one compares to you. We praise you today. Thank you, God, for the privilege of being in your presence. God, let us not take that for granted. God, I praise you for your provision in our life, Lord God, the opportunity to give back to you, God, to be obedient and to continue our worship. Bless the offering, God. Let it meet needs, Lord God. Thank you, God, for providing. Praise you, Jesus.
Amen. Who loves Jesus today? Yes? All right, we got a few. That's great. Praise God. I'm telling you, Jesus is so awesome. Does he just get better every day? Because he does for me. I don't know about you. If he's not getting better every day, then we're doing something wrong. Amen? Amen. Praise God. How many think the Word of God is important? Yes? How many read it every day? Same people, I hope, that are clapping, read it every day. So, because if you're not, then you're telling me, see, you say one thing, but you mean another. So, but I want to ask Linda Brown to come up. Two Lindas have gotten together, and they have an idea to help us love the Word of God more. Amen? Who wants to get in the Word of God more? I do. Amen. I don't believe we can get into it enough, right? So I'm going to give you this, and you just kind of explain what we're doing here.
I could shout loud enough without it.
Well, you can't.
You can't hear me anyway. Linda and I got together, and we got to talking about reading the Bible more and getting to know everybody more at the same time. But her idea was just for the women to get together, because God's Word says the older women should teach the younger women. And she wanted to have the women sign up on ages 40 and over and younger, and we were going to have us read starting chapter in the Bible, starting, and read it every 2 weeks and write down what we thought about it and questions we had for it. And you didn't even have to sign your name if you didn't want to. And we were going to have a box in the back, and you could put your, we had envelopes and everything.
You
could
envelopes.
Put what you wanted in it, and you would put it in that age group. And as you wrote, you could come back and pull one out of the older, and we would pull one out of the younger, so we would get to know you, and you would get to know us. Well, I thought it was for everybody. So I thought, well, the men should get involved too.
Amen.
Because I think everybody should be reading.
That's
and
right.
I think the men should be teaching the young men at the same time.
Amen.
Because you're just as important to me as everybody. So what I'm going to do is we're going to pass this around, and we're going to put check marks, because I don't need to know your names. And I want the women just to put a check mark, and the men, when you put your check mark, put an M beside it so we know how many want to be involved.
This is an interest board. Are you interested?
Yeah, so we want to find out if you're interested. And then if we get enough interested, then next week we'll tell you where the chapter starts, and we'll have it all set up for you, and we'll tell you where. And we'll start next week, and we'll go every 2 weeks with a chapter, and we'll tell you what book we're starting in.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody got any questions? All right. You explained it wonderfully. Nobody has questions. Good deal. I'm going to start passing this around. Don't let it be a distraction to you as we're hearing the Word of God right now. All right? Praise God. Today we are talking about unanswered prayers. Anybody ever had any of those? Anybody ever wonder why? Yes. Okay. I thought so. Not because I made this up on my own, but because this is what the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. And I was like, well, Lord, I'm sure that there are people here that have had unanswered prayers. Amen? But the thing I want to talk about to start out is motives. Motivation. What's your motivation in life? Why do you do what you do? You ever ask yourself that? Why am I doing this? Okay? Sometimes maybe we're doing it out of manipulation. That's our motivation, is to manipulate. Now maybe we aren't aware of that, but in a way we are manipulative, right? Okay? That could be our motivation. What was your motive to worship Jesus today? To draw near to Him, just to sing a song, because of the people around you were doing it, so you thought you'd just join in? What was your motive? Right? What was your motive to even come into the house of God today? Well, I don't want to call from the pastor on Monday morning. Well, if that's your motive, then you're probably not going to get much out of this, right? But if you, what was your motive to come in here? Well, you know, it makes me feel good. Well, I'm glad church makes you feel good. I'm glad that you're here because it makes you feel good. But our motive, or maybe your motive was, well, I came to be a part. I wanted to contribute to the body of Christ today. I didn't just come just to sit and just to hear. I want to contribute. I want to be a part of what's going on here, right? Maybe that's your motivation. But you see, everything we do has a motivation attached to it, does it not? Okay, how many of you ever have done something as a child for one of your parents, and you went up to them and said, hey, Mom and Dad, I did this for you. I mowed the lawn today. And they look at you and they say, okay, what do you want? Right? Okay? And they, because you don't think they're motivated, or they didn't think your motivations were pure. Come on, Mom and Dad. Huh? You do that to Lisa now. So your motivations weren't, and then you say, well, now that you mention it, right? Your motivations weren't pure. It wasn't just so you could bless your mom and dad with a nice manicured lawn. No, it was so you could get something in return. And you know, sometimes our motivations are messed up, right? Sometimes they're not accurate. They're not healthy motivations. But then there's other times where they are healthy, and that's a good thing. But I want to talk to you because the Bible gives us reasons why our prayers may not be answered. Okay, you may be asking why today, and maybe you never searched the Scriptures to hear from the Word of the Lord why maybe your prayers aren't answered. I'm not saying this is an exhaustive reasoning, but I'm telling you, these are reasons that God gives to us through His Word to show us why He doesn't do this. Now, I want to, this is a kind of an unpopular message. You know why? Because a lot of times our prayers don't get answered and we just want to blame God and leave it at that. Right? Well, God didn't want to do it. God didn't want to do that. And you know, God does have a purpose and a will and a plan that is way better than ours, right? But it's not always God's fault. Okay? Can we get on board with that? It's not always God's fault. So, as we talk about this, I want to start out with prayer matters. Does prayer matter to you? How often do you pray? Now, I'm not even going to say how long, because really the length of your prayer time really doesn't say that you're a great prayer warrior. It's the power of your prayer that matters, right? You could say a 30-second prayer, and it could be much more powerful than somebody that said a 2-minute prayer, right? But all because of the motives of your heart, for one. Your motives are pure. So what you're saying is coming through to the Lord, and it's your motives are pure, and so what you're saying is powerful, and God is hearing it. James chapter 5 and verse 16 says this, "Confess your sins to each other, and pray for each other that you may be healed. The earnest prayer," listen, "the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results." Did you hear that? This is why prayer matters, because the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. How many has ever needed results in your life? Yeah, there's times where we need results, right? There's times where we can be comforted with the words of Jesus is with you. He has never left you or forsaken you. And then there's times where it's like, okay, I get that, but I need some results. Right? So earnest prayer of a righteous person. For those in right relationship with God and continue to rely on Him and do what is right. When I think of an earnest prayer, my mind goes to Luke chapter 18. Because this woman was earnest in seeking Jesus to see God move on her behalf. Okay, it was, if you guys don't know, it's the widow, right? The widow was there before the judge, crying out day and night, would not leave the judge alone. I mean, earnestly seeking for help, right? To be justified. And she continued to seek and seek and seek and seek earnestly. Her heart would not give up, right? How many of us have ever prayed for something and after a couple months we're like, well, I guess God's not going to do that. I'm done. Right? I've done it. And we just give up. We just throw in the towel and say, okay, I guess that's over. Do you know that there are people that pray for 40 years for somebody and somebody got saved because of their prayer, because of their earnest prayer and not giving up? Earnest prayer of a righteous person. Earnest. This is what earnest means. Resulting from or showing sincere and intense conviction. Resulting from or showing sincere and intense conviction. That means the conviction of the Word of God on my heart is so intense that my prayers are so earnest that I believe what this says so much that I will not settle for anything less. Wow. Have you settled? Have you settled in your prayer life? I don't know. That's for you to decide, not me. But when we show forth right living in the eyes of God and we have heavy conviction of the power of God and character of God, it will cause our prayers to be completely effective. But it's up to us, right? When was the last time you were earnest in prayer? When was the last time you were earnest in prayer? Now let's turn back to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. In verse 3. And even when you ask, you don't get because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. Does anybody like this verse? You know, this is kind of in your face, isn't it? You ask, but you don't get because you only ask in because you want it to give you pleasure. That's when motives are wrong, right? If all we're looking for is personal pleasure, for us, you know, some people say, God, I just want this to end. Why do you want it to end? Why do you want it to end? So you can be comfortable again? So you can have some satisfaction? So the burden will be off your back? Why do you want it to end? Is it so? Because here's the main focus of our prayers should be. Our prayers and our desire for prayers to be answered is for one reason. So God can receive glory. That really should be our total motivation. Right? See, I know you're saying, well, yeah, but I really want to see my little bambino saved. And I'm glad you want to see your bambino saved. I want to see your bambino saved. But when you are praying, what is your motivation? So they'll start minding you? So they'll start doing what you tell them to do? Because if they have a relationship with Jesus, they're going to start doing. Or maybe they'll start listening to you. Maybe you'll have a better relationship with them. I don't know what it is, but your motive should be, God, I want you to save them because I believe that you can receive glory from it. You see, me-centered prayer is not God's will. Me-centered prayer is not God's will. I know we all like to get what we want, okay? I'm one of them, right? When I ask for my wife or something, and then I open something up and it's not that, I'm not going to lie and say I'm not disappointed sometimes, right? Okay? Or I say, that wasn't the right one, or yeah. But you see, isn't that sometimes how we go into our prayer closet? Right? We go in there and we're like, okay, God, this is what I want, this color, this size. Make it happen, God. And then we open up the prayer. We open up the answer, and it's like, This isn't what I asked for. Right? He's like, yeah, but it's better. But God, it doesn't look better to me. Right? Come on. Come on, we've all been there. But many times we pray these me-centered prayers. God, could this could really make my life easier. This could really make my life easier, God, if you can just do this. If you've ever read the book of Acts, then we can probably come to the conclusion that God is not really all about making our life easier. That's not really his plan, right? He is willing to allow you to go through persecution and suffering. He is willing to do that. But he's also willing to rescue you in those hard times as well. But here's what I want us to understand. Prayer is less about getting what we want and more about becoming who we need to be. Do you hear that? Prayer is less about getting what we want and more about becoming who we need to be. See, when you go into your prayer closet, your motivation should not to have your whole laundry list of things answered by God. Your heart and your motivation should be, God, I want to become like you. And as I become like you, I know that the things that I want in my life are going to begin to happen. As I seek you first, you're going to add all the other things. Right? See, the presence of God will not always fix your problems, but it will clarify your perspective. Amen? Sometimes our perspective is all messed up. And sometimes we just need a little bit of time in the presence of Almighty God for our perspective to change. And that's exactly what we need. See, if we will take time to pray and spend that time with God, He can take us from a me-focused to a he-focused heart and motivation in our lives. When we pray, it should not always be about us, but it should be about the purpose and will of God and about God getting glory. Are your motives pure today? Are your motives pure today in your prayer life? Are your motives pure in what you do and why you do it? I want to tell a story about a person, a couple of people, who had good, one had good motives and one didn't have such good motives. You've read it before, I'm sure. It's found in Luke chapter 18, which I don't believe is any kind of coincidence that this is right after talking about the persistent, earnest prayer of the woman, of the widow, right? And now this parable comes right after it. Okay, it's all about motivation, church. It's all about motivation. Let's look at this in verse 9, chapter 18, verse 9. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. Two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other a despised tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer. I thank you, God, that I am not like other people. Cheaters, sinners, adulterers, I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give you a tenth of my income. Now let me ask you this. Is this a me-centered prayer or a he-centered prayer? I would say he's going into there, his motives are, look how good I am, God. Because I've done so much good, then I expect you to do good to me. Right? Okay, if we go into our prayer, can I just tell you, this is not a work-based relationship. This is a grace-based relationship. You can go in, you can tell God everything that you've done good. You can tell God all the things that you've done, that you pay your tithe every week, and man, you do this. Or you can go in, you can do what this other guy did. And it says this. But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, Oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. I tell you this, sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. See, if your motivation is to exalt yourself, you're prepared to be humbled. right? But if your motivation is to come in with humility and willing to submit to God and say, God, I'm nothing. God, my plan is nothing compared to your plan. I need your plan to be worked out in my life. You see, so often we come into our prayer closet and say, God, I've got a plan. I've got a plan. And we tell him our plan, man, we think it's a really great plan, right? We think, God, if you will just do it this way, it's going to work out really, really well. Instead of coming in and say, God, I got nothing. Instead of coming in and say, God, I got nothing. God, I've got a plan, God, but I don't even want to bring my plan to you because your plan's way better than my plan, and I want you to share your plan with me. See the difference of motivation there? One says I'm right, the other says he's right. Are you getting this, church? You getting it? See, there are times when the prayers we are praying aren't necessarily wrong in themselves. Okay? The prayer isn't wrong. It's the motivation behind the prayer that's wrong. Right? John chapter 14 and verse 14. Because I really want to clear the air. I don't want people to think that, you know, okay, if my motives are right, then I can just get whatever I want, right? If I do this and my motives are pure, then I'm going to ask Jesus and he's just going to do it. Because John chapter 14, verse 14 says this. Yes, ask anything in my name and I will do it. Did you hear that? Ask anything in my name and I will do it. Jesus just said, if you will ask anything in his name, he will do it. Anybody ever tested that? God, I want $1 million in Jesus' name. God, I want a new Ferrari in Jesus' name. And I want you to foot the bill for the insurance in Jesus' name. Come on. God, I want this in Jesus' name. Is that really what this is about? Is that really what Jesus is saying? Are my motives pure? Why do I want $1 million? Do I need $1 million? No. Do I need a Ferrari? Oh, it'd be really cool. But God's not interested in how cool it is, right? How cool I would look in it, right? It'd have to be black with silver trim. It'd be really cool. But anyway. Yeah. In Jesus' name, amen. You see, our motives would be wrong, right? Because that's not what God, that's not what Jesus was meaning. Jesus didn't just say you could just say whatever you want and just attach his name on the end of it in the name of Jesus. You know, and I don't even know if it was intended for us to declare at the end of every prayer, in Jesus' name we pray. You know, I know what Jesus is saying here is align yourself with my will and my purpose. See, align your life with my will and my purpose. And as you do that, you are living out and you're living in and you're praying in my name, right? Your motives are now pure. It's no longer about you, but it's about me. Pure motives. There was somebody, you know, I don't know about you, but I have to pray about this pretty consistently. I have to pray that my motives are right. I can't just go every day and just get to that place like, oh yeah, my motives are right, right? My motives are okay, because they're not. I have to seek God and I have to say, God, I know you can see my heart right now. And I know you see the corruption inside my heart. I know you see impure motives inside of me. And God, I don't want impure motives in my heart. So I just give those, I just pray you'll cleanse me from those impure motives, and God, that you will help me to be pure in your sight, in my motivations. I have to do that on a regular basis. Because, you know, especially in ministry, you know, your motivations can get all askewed, right? Why do I want to see people here? Okay, what could my motivation could be? Well, because I want them to come and I want them to hear the Word of God and I want them to express their worship towards Jesus, right? That's what it should be. But it could be that, well, I want them to come and just to hear me preach. Right? That's wrong. If that's my motivation, I'm wrong. Right? I don't even want to be up here, honestly, if that's my motivation. If I ever get to that place, man, I don't want God to strike me down up here on this stage. Because I feel like that's what would happen to me, because He knows that I know. Right? He knows that I know that my motivation should never be that. And if it ever gets to that, then He would know that I would know that He knows what I know. Do you get that? Okay. Have to sign that. Okay. But you see, our motives must be pure. And David knew that too. There was a time where David's motives weren't so pure, right? And we know what happened. David went off the deep end, man. His motives weren't so hot. But then, you know, he started to realize, you know what? I've got to keep my motives pure before the Lord. I've got to do what He tells me to do. And then we look in Psalm chapter 139, one of the most powerful prayers I believe that David ever prayed. And it says this in verse 23. It says, "Search me, O God." Amen. Man, that's where it should start right there. If we want our motives to be pure, we want our hearts to be pure before God, we should come into our prayer closet and say, "Search me, O God. Just search me. Know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts." And then we're asking Him to do something. Point out anything in me that offends you. Oh, man. God, if I have a motive, God, that it offends you, just point it out. God, I want to get rid of it. I don't want to have it in me anymore. God, I want to cast it as far away from me as I possibly can. I hope that's our heart when we go into our prayer closet. I hope we don't go in there and we get offended by God because He tells us we've got impure motives. Right? How many's done that? Okay, we should be going in and asking Him if there's anything that offends Him, but we go in there and He tells us what offends Him, and we get offended. When all He's doing is trying to get you to a place where your motives are pure and He can hear your prayer the way you want Him to hear it. Amen? It says, "Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life." See, why would David pray this way? David had a concern that there could be something in him or in his life that could hinder his prayers. He had a concern. He didn't want anything to come and block the fellowship that him and the Father had. Have you ever had anything block the fellowship between you and God? Oh, man, those are ugly days. I'm telling you, those are bad days when you know there's just seems like a wall, right? I'm thankful that those days are few and far between, but I know it when it's there, and then I have to get on my face before God, and God, search me. Search me. Search me, God. Point out anything in me that offends you. See, he wanted to make sure his motives were pure. When was the last time you checked your motives? Our hearts have a lot to do with why our prayers aren't heard. From our hearts flow our motives, and it also be, and our hearts can become corrupted. When we come to the conclusion that this life is to be lived out for the sake of Christ and His kingdom, then we understand this is just a precursor to the life we all want in heaven, right? Now, when I talk about the life we all want in heaven, why are you serving Jesus today? What are your motives for that? Well, because I want my ticket. I want my ticket, right? I got my golden ticket to the streets of gold. And that's why I serve Jesus. Can I just tell you something? If that's your whole motivation for serving Christ, eventually that ticket's going to, you're going to look at it and be like, yeah, I remember that day. You're just going to toss it back in the drawer, right? You're going to toss that ticket back in the drawer and you're just going to be like, oh, yeah, one day, you know, I'll get there. If that's your motivation. I think I've shared this story before, but I'm going to share it again because it goes right along with this. There were a couple of men that were getting on an airplane. Both of them were given a parachute. But one was told that this parachute was going to make his ride much more comfortable. Okay, his plane ride was going to be so nice, and he was just going to enjoy it so much because he had this parachute on his back. And then the other one was given a parachute, and he was told, hey, this plane's going to go down in 30 minutes. If you don't have this parachute on your back, you're going down with it. Okay? The other one with the parachute on his back that was told that it was going to make his ride more comfortable sat there and was like, oh, why'd they tell me that? They're so wrong, man. This parachute is so annoying. There's no way this is more comfortable than just sitting in this chair, right? But the other one that was told that the plane's going down in 30 minutes, he had that parachute on. You know what? He was sitting there like, oh, it's nice to have the assurance that I've got this parachute on, knowing this plane's going down in 30 minutes, right? See, the motivations were different, right? His motivation was, well, this is supposed to make me more comfortable. And a lot of times in our lives, that's what we come to Jesus and people tell us, oh, your life's going to be so much better. And you know what? Jesus does offer abundant life, right? And he does. And it is powerful. And it's a spiritually abundant life. Amen? If you want peace in the midst of your chaos, Jesus is the one. Amen? If you want joy in the midst of your sorrow, Jesus is the one. Okay, but a lot of times we come to Jesus, we hear these preach, oh, if you'll come to Jesus, your life's going to be blessed. And then what happens? We walk out the door, and it's not as blessed as we thought it would be. And we're like, man, this doesn't feel very good, right? This doesn't feel great. And eventually, because it's not as blessed as the preacher said it was going to be, we take that parachute and we throw it on the ground and say, forget it. I'm not going to wear that thing anymore. Y'all are a bunch of liars. But the other person, right? They were given the parachute. We know that this world is going to come to an end, don't we? And we know that we want to take as many people with us as we can, right? Okay, serving Jesus, our motivation should be the two greatest commandments. Amen? Love God and love people. If your motives don't really have to go beyond that, if you will do those two things, I can guarantee you're going to have abundant life. It may not look like what you want it to look like, but it's going to look really, really good. Yeah, you may get spit on. Man, I was loving them, God, and they spit in my face. Hey, you love God and love people. How do you feel about it? You did what you were supposed to do for the Lord. You served God in the right way. So you got a little spit on your face. That's what soap's for. But none of us really look at that, right? If we just got spit in the face telling somebody about Jesus, they're going to get an old knuckle sandwich. I'm going to show you how much Jesus loves you today. But obviously that wouldn't be pure heart either, would it? That wouldn't come from a pure heart. I want to end with this scripture. Jesus talking about motivation still, our motives of our heart. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5 and 6, it says, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray publicly on street corners and in the synagogues where everyone can see them. Did you hear that? What's their motivation? Hey guys, look how holy I am. Look how amazingly spiritual that I am. Okay, I want you to see, I'm going to pray as loud as I can for as long as I can so you can just see how spiritual I am today. That's what their motivation was. They wanted everybody to know that they were one up on them. That they were up here and you were down here. Okay? I don't believe that Jesus was just like, don't ever pray in public. He was just saying, make sure your motives are pure if you're going to pray in public. If you're praying to be heard by someone else. See, if we're praying to be heard by man, what's that going to do for us? Nothing, right? Our motives aren't pure in that way, and it does absolutely nothing for us. And this is what Jesus said. I tell you the truth that this is the reward they will ever get. This is the only reward they'll ever get. So the only reward you're going to get is somebody heard you and thought you were spiritual. Woo! Man, thanks God. That was such an awesome reward. Somebody really thought I was a spiritual giant because they heard me pray. But I got absolutely no results from the prayer that I prayed besides that. Is that really what we want? I know it's not. You don't have to answer that. I know that's not what we want, and we should never pray in a way. That's what I love about the people that come up here. I know these people's hearts. They wouldn't be up here if I didn't think that they weren't praying according to the Lord, right? If their hearts weren't pure, If they were up here saying, yep, they're coming up to me because I'm spiritual. Okay, they would be back in their seat and they would never be back up here again. Right? Because those are impure motives. Impure motives that we do not want to happen here. Then Jesus takes it a little further. When you pray, go away by yourself, shut the door behind you, and pray to your Father in private. Then your Father who sees everything will reward you. Will reward you. So, what Jesus is saying, if you will let him know, and your prayer will be to him and not so other people can hear you, then God's going to reward you, and your reward isn't just going to be so that man heard you. That's pretty awesome, right? But your motive has to be pure. If you're walking around wanting to be more spiritual, if your motivation is to look holier than other people, then your motivations are wrong. When our hearts are right before God, then we aren't praying to be heard or praying to impress others. Again, if we are more interested in me and less interested in God, then our motives are wrong and we should not expect anything from the Lord. So I'm asking you today, church, how many want to see their prayers answered? This is just the first week of this. We've got a lot more. I'm telling you, there's a lot in the Bible that talks about hindered prayer, about unanswered prayer. Why doesn't God answer our prayer? But how many can say, you know what? I want my prayers to be answered. I want God to hear my cry. I want God to listen when I pray to him. Not only do I want him to listen, but I want him to respond to my prayers. Right? I want Jesus to respond to what I pray. Well, this is the first step of many. But you know, I want us to look at this because I want you right now, just where you're seated right now, I want you to ask God this. I want you to say this to God. Search me, O God, and see if there's anything impure in me. Search me, God. Come on, just ask him right now, church. Right where you're sitting. Seated, just ask him if there's anything in you that would be hindering your prayer, any motivations, any motives inside of you that are not pure, that are not right, that you would just ask him to just take them and release them from you and allow him to do the work that he wants to do. You see, this one thing, church, could change and empower your prayer life in such a way that you could begin to see results taking place in your life. The question is do we care? Do we care if our motives are pure? Do we really care? Because I'm telling you, if you will truly ask God today to search your heart and you will allow him to speak to you and tell you what it is you need to get rid of, what offends him, then he will do it. But if you're sitting there today and you're asking God to search you and then he tells you and you get offended by it, by saying, God, I don't think that's true, then you can't be delivered from it. Church, I want us to be a powerful, prayer-effective church. A prayer-effective people. I want our prayers to be heard. I want our prayers to be responded to. But I know it can't happen if we aren't praying with a pure heart, with pure motives. Question is why do you pray? Why do you pray? Well, I want God's protection on my family. That's great. As long as you're going to give him glory when he shows his hand of protection on your family. Why do you want what you want? Is it to consume it upon your own pleasure, or is it so he can receive glory? Let's just sit here a moment. As Kenny sings this song, let's just sit here a moment and allow God to search our hearts. Let him speak to you in this moment. We can take our time. Lunch is almost ready. Just sit here and just allow the Spirit of God to make you aware of the motives of your heart. As Kenny sings, let's just take this time. If you want to come down here and kneel, you can come down here and kneel. If that helps you to focus more, that's great. If you want me to pray with you, I will pray with you. But let's make sure our motives are pure this morning.
Change my heart, oh God.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter, and I am the clay. Mold me and make me, oh, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Take my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter, and I am the clay. Mold me and make me, oh, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever
Lord, let that be the prayer of all of us today. God, as we walk out of this building, where God, as we begin to get busy with life, I pray, God, that the Spirit of God will remind us every day, Lord, to check our hearts, to search our hearts, Lord, to see if there is anything in our hearts, Lord God, that would offend you, that would hinder our prayers, Lord God, that would hinder you hearing them and responding to them. Father God, we want to see prayers be answered. We want to see your hand move in a powerful way. But God, that is not our motivation. Our motivation is to know you, to give you glory because of your powerful hand, Father. So God, I just pray, God, that our motives would be pure, our hearts would be pure in your sight. God, touch this church. Help us, Lord, to live a life that would be about bringing you glory. It's truly all about you, Jesus. It is not about us. We love you, we praise you, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless y'all. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord today. We got lunch right out there. Stick around. Have a meal. I don't care if you brought anything or not. Come on, stick around and have some food.